Hello and welcome to today's video. In it, we're going to be discussing another set of simple tips and tricks for concrete related tasks, focusing on views and grids. So let's go ahead and jump right in. Our first tip revolves around what we call to be a work area. The work area, for those who are unfamiliar, is the bounding box in which objects within, partially or fully, will be shown on screen. And if they are outside this work area, they won't be shown, but still exist in the model. In our model views, this is represented by a green dashed bounding box that you can see here on screen. This is easy to identify and it allows users to understand quickly where their work area is and when they should choose to redefine it, where it has been changed to. This can be very helpful, however, not all users prefer to have this type of object representation on screen. The good news is we can easily turn this off. We can go to our file menu, go down to our settings, then advanced options, or we can simply hit Control E to bring up this dialog box. Once it's open, we'll just hit in all categories for our search and then search work area. The second option that's listed is XS hide work area. Its default value is false and we're just going to want to change that to true. We're going to apply our change and hit OK. The last step of this is to close any active views and then open them back up. We can do that by coming over to our view list, double clicking on our 3D view, and as you can see now, that bounding box is gone. This next tip is helpful for all users who want to quickly kind of get around their model but snap to a specific plane. There's a couple of ways to do that. New in 2024 for Tekla structures, we can use our UCS icon down here at the bottom right of our view and snap to any one of the planes in the X, Y, and or Z axis. This allows us to use a singular view and quickly get to the elevation or perspective of our model objects that we wish. Now, what's been around for a while, but you may not know, is if you select an object and then go to your contextual toolbar, which if you do not see on screen, you can bring up by hitting the hotkey Control K. But once it's open, selecting your object, you can hit the View Angle icon, which allows you to change your view to any side, face, or of your part that you have selected. This can be very, very helpful when you need to quickly get to a wall panel or beam and insert some reinforcement, embedments, lifters, and so on and so forth. This next tip allows us to tie our grids to our views a little bit more directly. When we start our projects, we establish our grid parameters through the properties pane, providing spacing in the X, Y, and Z axis, well as labels associated with that. But did you know that you can create views along your grid lines automatically? It's very simple to execute. Once you have the grid selected here, you can come up to the View ribbon and then go to New View and then Along Grid Lines. Alternatively, you can also select the view and then just right click Create View and Along Grid Lines. It brings up a dialog box that allows us to create views along grid lines for rectangular and radial grids. If we open up our view list, we can see we don't have any created here. If we just make sure our grid is selected and hit Create button, we create a multitude of grids very quickly along each of the planes, both vertically and plan view. This becomes very helpful when it comes to modeling different objects at different elevations or creating drawing views as well. For example, if we go ahead and select plan at elevation floor 3, we can open that up. Now we don't see our objects down below because it's exceeding the work area from our previous tip, but we can vertically tile these two views so we can see them in tandem. And if we were to say create a concrete beam at this elevation along D line, it's going to pop up at a higher elevation above our objects here at ground level. Being able to work in a plane and the correct elevation while creating your object saves you time from having to create it at the wrong elevation, selecting it, right-clicking, and then either moving it manually or using Move Linear to move it up to the correct elevation. Creating grids can save you a lot of time in modeling your objects, as well as creating the appropriate view for your drawings in the future. Now, this last tip that we have is centered around our grids, but it's one that allows us to work smart and not hard in many cases. So I have the grid selected here, and as we've talked about, you populate your spacing and your labels for X, Y, and Z axes, as well as some other information, and then you can change the color and font size down below. Now, there's one other option that gets overlooked pretty often, and that is magnetic grid plane. The default for most grids is that it's set to no, at least in the cast in place and rebar detailing rules for the United States. And if that what that means is that when we go ahead and make a change to our grid, none of the objects will travel with the grid lines as they change, right? Which is typical behavior I think most users are accustomed to, at least for cast in place. However, if we change this option to yes, modify the change, and then make that exact same spacing change, our objects do travel. Well, at least most of them traveled, as you can see here on screen. We do have a culprit here who didn't, and that's deliberate for our example. It's important to point out that if you want to capitalize on the magnetism of grid planes, you need to model your endpoints to the grid intersections. So if we snap to plan view, if we look at this beam, we can see here that the endpoint is actually in the center of the grid intersection over the pad footing and the column. And we've used a component from the applications and components side pane called fit beams to columns to make sure that this was snug up and trimmed so you get the correct linear footage and volume. Make sure you select the right option from this dialog in the way you would like those objects to fit together and apply and then simply execute. So if we undo our change and come back and execute this tool, selecting our beam and then our column and doing it again on the other side, and then we can repeat the change, whether it be from the properties pane or in this case, we'll go ahead and just drag this grid line that way. You can see that the change happens. And now everything is tight and snug. This is very useful for times where you have key structural elements tied to a grid system inside your project. If you need to make updates, revisions, or changes, or compensate for human error, this can save you a lot of time in moving objects. But you need to make sure that endpoints rest or connect over the grid system in order for it to apply. Now, in cases where that doesn't happen, you can actually use construction objects to help you do the same thing. From the Edit ribbon, if you go to Construction Objects, you can choose a plane or a line, and both of those have an option in the Properties pane to be magnetic. So what this means is that you can add additional construction lines as infills in your grid system or in other angles in different planes, and then model objects over them, such as a beam. And then when we select that object, we can go ahead and move it, and the beam will travel, saving you lots of time with changes, updates, and correction for error. This concludes our video. Thank you for watching. Want to learn more about this topic or how to get started with Tekla structures? Just check out the video's description for links to our user assistance page, getting started guide, and our online campus.